Nancy Hall, and I'm the chairperson of the Staff Council Employee Relations Committee. Wanted to let you know, we also have some refreshments in the back of the room. Please feel free to get up whenever you like to get a drink or a snack. I'd like to take a moment, if I may, to thank the committee members of the Employee Relations Committee for their work this year. They've been a great help getting everything together for us. And they are Vicki Banks, Andrea Bomey, Melissa Chase, Lauren Clifford, Martin Collins, Crystal Cox, Susan Christ, Jamie Edwards, Michelle Fowler, Rusty Hochhalter, Cedric Jones, Angie Lansing, Susan McNeely, Rick Murdoch, and Carolyn Rolfing. I'd really appreciate them and depend on them for getting the work of the committee done through the course of the year. I'd like to say a special thank you to Mr. Michael Moore with the Office of Information Technology Multimedia Research for video capturing our presentation today. Thank you for stepping in and helping us. Our first topic of conversation today is community service and engagement. We have here with us Mrs. Jessica Starr. She's going to talk with us a little bit about community service. If some of you volunteer for Donaghy Day, that's just a small part of what Jessica's office does. So if you would, let's welcome Jessica. Thank you.
Good morning. First question, how many of you use your community service leave? Oh, I got two back there that don't. I'm gonna give you some options, okay? I'm gonna talk a little bit about community service leave and how our office can help you. As employees here at the university, full-time employees have 15 hours that they can utilize during the academic year of paid service leave. Part-time employees have 7 hours, and our public safety officers, they have 8 based on their shift times. I want to talk a little bit about the service options, but first I'm going to show you on the Center for Community Engagement's website where community service leave is. And it'll come up here in a little bit. A lot of times our staff use their community service leave to chaperone field trips, whether it's for their children, whether it's for their grandchildren, that's an option. Here on the community service leave page, you can see you have your option to do community service leave request right here. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about the Sycamore Service Challenge here in a little bit. This is something new that we are opening up for staff this year because we have several requests for it. For those of you that maybe don't use your community service leave or maybe haven't, perhaps you don't know where you could do your service at, or maybe other opportunities that you could get involved with. We get constant requests in our office, almost daily, requests for volunteers, both students and staff. For example, I know several people volunteer for Meals on Wheels. Several people volunteer with Vigo County School Corporation. We have opportunities that are close to campus, both off campus. Not everybody, just because we work here in Terre Haute, not everybody necessarily wants to do their community service leave in Terre Haute. People do it in Brazil, Marshall, Paris, Sullivan, Park County. It just depends on what you're interested in. I do coordinate community service leave. I'm just gonna pull this up. When you click on this form here, it'll come up here in just a minute, hopefully. There we go. This takes you to the service request that you fill out to request your community service leave with your supervisor's approval. It's pretty self-explanatory in here. Your department, your name, your email address, if you have permission from your supervisor's name, their contact information, if you're paid monthly or biweekly. It's probably not going to let me go to the next screen because these are all hard set information. So why don't I just put in my information so you guys can see the next screen here. Because we want to know where you are going to be doing your service at. And I actually approve service. I have denied service opportunities before. It depends on what the request is. I'm just going to put in a fake number here. I don't want to put in my real one. We have several staff members that are mentors within the Vigo County School Corporation, particularly at Franklin Elementary. Some people are big brothers and big sisters. It just depends on what you're interested in. We get, like I said, we get a lot of requests from the community. We had, for example, we had staff 2 weeks ago that volunteered to help with hearing tests at Franklin Elementary. They had a great time. I had a few staff members email me afterwards and they said, hey, I would like to sign up again next year when it comes around. We're just gonna pick. I can find my own department here. Okay, I'm just gonna type in. I'm just doing this as a test here so you guys can see. Okay. Oh, it's gotta be valid, there you go. You gotta put in the real number. I should know that, I set this up. Here's, I have not ran the data yet from last academic year because I if anyone would like to know how many hours both non-exempt and exempt have completed last academic year, I can provide that information. I will say we have increased each year, which is a good thing. Since community service leave has come into effect, our hours have gone up for staff that have completed those hours in the community. We're still not where I think we should be. Staff, I have some staff that want more time. They're like, is there any way we could request more time? Unfortunately, no, I can't prove that case until everybody utilizes all their time. On here, this is where you select your date. You can select multiple dates on here. The hours per day, some people have standing volunteer opportunities. Perhaps maybe you're a volunteer with CASA and you have a court appointment, you know you're gonna be going to court once a month to advocate for a child. This is key right here. Name an agency where you are completing your service. We do have, if you do not see your service site listed in here, you have the option of adding it with other down here. What you're gonna be doing at your service site, again, you have the option of other to select if none of these fit your task that you're going to be doing. And then you would just hit submit. This triggers an email to me, and then I respond back to you, hopefully in a timely manner, and yes, your service is approved. Now sometimes staff do their service, they don't report it, they forget about reporting it here, and I get an email from payroll with a list, so I know all the community service hours that has been completed. And sometimes you'll get an email from me saying, hey, you completed your service hours, but you didn't log it in with community engagement. Please fill out this survey. And that's when you would fill this out. Ideally, we want staff to fill it out before they do their community service leave. That is something that I want to emphasize. You do your community service leave request before you do your service. Sometimes it doesn't always happen that way, but I did want to mention that. Okay, so we've had several staff requests. Hey, we want to be able to tell community engagement, we want to be able to share with the university what we're doing outside of our community service leave. That's paid time off. So what are you doing outside of work hours? So we already had this for students, the Sycamore Service Challenge, and we just added the option for staff to be able to participate in this as well. So this takes you to a survey. You select on here, student, faculty, or staff, and you just fill it out. You can do reoccurring on this as well, organization you served at, location, groups benefited, type of work, and any additional comments. This is something that we can pull at the end of the year. For example, I know when we do our reviews, there's a component on there that you can report service that you've done. Not everybody remembers what they did in July, where they served their volunteer hours at. This is you are the ones that are recording this. We would like to be able to utilize this information for some of our service awards for the Center for Community Engagement at the end of the year. We have not formally pushed this out to staff broadly at on campus yet. We've had a few select staff members that have sort of tested it with us. We are ready to push it out, so there will be an announcement about this next week in the global. So, staff council, you're the first to hear about this. Questions on any of this?
Are there any limits on the Sycamore Service Challenge, like the volunteer work that you do?
No.
So it can be anything?
Yep. Okay. Yeah.
Are religious and faith-based organizations eligible?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Why does Donaghy not count as community engagement hours?
Oh, for like spring Donaghy Day?
Yeah.
Well, and even fall Donaghy Day. We had discussion about this in our office. We've also had discussion about this with Sherry O'Neill. We see it as a service to another department on campus, okay? Which is not necessarily, I mean, you are volunteering, but it's not actually community service leave. For example, the flower bulb planting that was in the global this week, Steph Kroll had reached out to me and said, hey, we got thousands of bulbs we need to plant. We don't have enough time to get them in the ground. Is there something we can do? You are just volunteering your time as a Sycamore employee helping out another department that needs assistance for an hour and a half. No different than, say for example, Arts and Sciences was having an event and they needed some meet and greet or something. I am just being a good Sycamore employee helping out another department on campus. You're welcome. Other questions? Yes?
Do you have a spot where we can find what events that we can volunteer at on the website?
We are working on that. Let me back up here. We launched a Google Calendar. I know some of our IT people are probably cringing with that, but let me get back to our page here. Get back to my home page. And we're trying to post both for students and staff on here. So this is live, we can update it at any time. Obviously our stop and serves are on there. We have a lot of things that occur on the weekends. I would like to do a form on our website of just upcoming service events and that you could click on and here you go, here's the information. That's still a work in process. Sometimes it's hard when we get last minute requests, so that's why we kind of utilize staff council. Hey, can you post this on your social media? We're gonna post it on ours. There's a couple events this weekend that community partners are still looking for volunteers for that they're short on. And some are actually, one is at the Holman Center that staff could be using their service time on Friday if they wanted to. It's setting up for a fundraiser that's happening on Saturday. So it is an ongoing process trying to communicate with campus opportunities. There's a lot of them and our office is trying to coordinate that. What other questions? I got a question for you two ladies over there. How come you haven't utilized your time?
Because we do that. I'm the fundraising committee here in the library, so we do so much fundraising this way that we don't use the community service time for that.
Okay.
So that's how I spend my and do my stuff.
Okay. How about you?
Well, I still think of it as a relatively new concept.
Okay.
Even though it's been around for, what, 3 years?
I think it's been around for at least five.
See, that's how my time is.
Maybe four. No, at least five, because I've been working on campus. I'll celebrate 5 years in April. So it's been here since I've started.
I think sometimes, too, it's hard for one-person offices.
Yes,
to be able to get out of the office for any length of time.
Mm-hmm.
They may want to use their hours, but don't have that opportunity.
Right. Well, and that's why we try to encourage with Donaghy Day. Spring Donaghy Day will look a little bit different this year. We're not ready to roll out the concept yet, but it is going to look a little bit different. That's why we try and encourage offices, hey, shut down for a couple hours. I know that's very hard, but it's good team building for your office, good chance, it's a good opportunity to get out of the office, get some fresh air, help the community out, help the campus community out. So watch for information on that next semester. It will take place in April, but we're not ready to release details yet to campus. We're still working on logistics. Any other questions? I don't have anything else. So if you do have further questions, you can contact me. You can send me an email, Jessica Starr in the Center for Community Engagement. I'm always available if you want me to come meet with you, if you need suggestions. We're here to help. Community Engagement's here to help. So thank you.
Michelle's going to talk with us about OLLI. Some of you, I'm sure, probably heard about OLLI, and she's going to talk with us a little bit about that and let us know exactly what OLLI's about.
Thank you. Thanks. Good morning. Can you hear me? I don't know if I'm going through both mics or not. How many of you have ever heard of the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute at Indiana State University? That's lots of you. That's great. Okay, how many of you have ever participated in anything that the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute has done in Indiana State? Great, a couple. Well, just to kind of give you a little bit of background, we are a lifelong learning program geared towards people who are 50 and older. There isn't an age requirement, so you actually don't have to be 50 or older in order to participate. There has been a lifelong learning program at Indiana State University since 1997. That was when it was called the Dewey Institute. In 2007, we received our first grant from the Osher Foundation, and that's when we changed our name. In 2010, we received our $1 million endowment, which makes us a permanent entity at Indiana State University. There are over 120 Osher Lifelong Learning Institutes throughout the country. The goal of the foundation was to have at least one Osher Lifelong Learning Institute in every state. So when we applied for that first initial grant, we were up against Purdue and IU, and we actually beat all of them out, mainly for the sheer fact that we were so closely connected to the university, and the university was willing to support us in those kinds of programming. So we have basically are going to celebrate our 20-year lifelong learning anniversary in 2017 and our 10-year Osher lifelong learning anniversary in 2017 as well. So next year we're looking at some programming that will do something along the lines of like a flashback of old programs that we're redoing again, or kind of honoring some of those initial partners that helped us. As far as specific programs that we offer classes. They can be straight OLLI classes, which usually meet somewhere in between three or four times, giving a during time period. We also partner with university classes, where our OLLI members will go into a regular university class for an entire semester. In addition to that, we do weekly presentations, which covers a wide range of different kinds of topics. And then we have special events, which can be anything from a trip, it could be a tour locally, it can be a luncheon. We always kind of laugh at my office about the fact that my people like to eat and drink a lot. So we have wine tastings and bourbon tastings, and sometimes we do coffee tastings. But there's always an educational component to everything that we do, including the trips. So there's a lot of different opportunities that you can do, and even though you're still currently working, we have a lot of people that will actually go with us on bigger trips, or even trips that we're doing to Bloomington, to the opera, because those will be on Friday nights. So there's a lot of ways that you can actually still participate in those if you're interested. Another way that you can necessarily get involved with the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute is by actually doing a program. I think Jessica just left, but I'm pretty sure that we are one of those programs that you can use your community service for. And we've had several staff members do that over the last couple of years. Billy and Teresa in the controller's office taught a cake decorating class. Teresa did a handwriting analysis presentation for us at one point in time. We have a lot of faculty that will necessarily help us out with programming. So there's a lot of different ways. And you don't have to be a complete expert in something. We kind of laugh because we have a lot of faculty that don't want to necessarily teach what they teach here on campus, but they have a hobby. So I have Dr. Buffington, who is in the business department, but when he does something for me, it's all about the Civil War because that's where his passion lies. So he will come dressed in his Civil War outfit, and his wife will come with him, and they might do a class for us, and they might do a presentation, but it's kind of geared towards, you know, what you're really interested in and something that you're really interested in sharing with other people. As far as our age range goes, the majority of our members are somewhere in between the ages of 65 and 75. I think my youngest member is in her late 40s and my oldest member is in her late 90s. So we cover a wide variety of different kinds of ages. Now, in all honesty, we've even had a 7-year-old come and do one of our classes with us when we were doing a Harry Potter class, and that was a lot of fun. So we enjoyed having a younger person in our class, and he probably knew more about it than any of the rest of them in the class. So as far as upcoming programming, we have a smartphone class that is being taught by Dr. McLaren. We are going to have what I think is kind of one of those fun classes where we're looking at history, but we're looking at it through the lens of TV. So we're going to be looking at I Love Lucy and Leave It to Beaver and the Dick Van Dyke Show, and kind of talking about how those specific shows show their specific time period and how things have changed from that, and kind of comparing it to current time. In addition to that, we do a lot of other classes as far as like a jewelry making class. We're going to have a Shakespeare class. We do have water aerobics because at one point in time it became an issue for people who wanted to have some sort of water aerobics when the YMCA shut down. And since it's been back up, we still have people who want to take it through us, so we still offer that. But we have a wide variety of different kinds of programming along those lines. Everything that we do is kind of like an introduction to something, and it kind of sparks your interest or gives you a little bit more information about it, and then you can go out and learn more about that. Or you can ask me and say, Michelle, we want to learn a little bit more about that. Will you do another class? And we've continued to do that. One of the continuing classes that we've offered is an Indiana history class. And we literally started with a geographical time of how Indiana formed and why we have so much limestone, and started from there and have worked our way up past the Civil War. So those are kind of done in three session classes, a class in religion. So that's something that you don't get to take very often from anywhere else. Any questions? Yes.
Give us a price range depending on just a beginning class to one of your more extensive trips.
Sure. As far as the program itself goes, there is a $40 membership fee. We do offer one free class every semester, whether you're a member or not. In order to participate in those. Most of the time the classes range anywhere from $10 to maybe $20 if you're taking more than one class. As far as trips and those kinds of things go, if it's a special event and it's here in town, the minimum would be like a $5 charge, and then the maximum, depending on where you're going, New England trips, and we did a trip to New York this spring. Those are probably around $3,000. So, I mean, there's a pretty wide range, and we have trips that will be gone for anywhere from 8 to 10 days. So it's a pretty wide range. And then the Wednesday presentations, those are all free, and they're open to the public as well. Yes, ma'am.
If you volunteer, do you have to be a member?
No, you don't. The majority of the people who, about half, are members and half aren't. We have a lot, like I said, a lot of faculty that will necessarily come and do presentations for us that are current faculty. We have faculty from Rose Holman that do programs for us. We have faculty from St. Mary's of the Woods that do programming for us. We have community agencies that come in and do programming for us. We do a lot with like the state police and the local police department, as well as community theater, the SWOPE. So we partner with a lot. We probably have, in general, including campus, over 30 partners that we partner with during a given year in order to provide different kinds of programming and to kind of help promote what they're doing, and then also to kind of coordinate with what we're doing. Other questions? All right. If you have any interest in taking part in the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute, please feel free to contact me if you've got questions about can I attend something. You know, just shoot me an email. We always have students from campus that are emailing me and asking me, can I go to that Wednesday presentation? Absolutely. I had one that was in a journalism class and needed to attend something that was community-based and came to our presidential election class. I think he got kind of surprised because the biggest difference between my OLLI members and regular college students is they like to talk and they will ask lots of questions, and it might turn into a debate, especially given the presidential election class. So we have students that participate in our classes every once in a while, in addition to the ones that we take with university students. So if you have students that have some sort of a community-based project that they need to do and you think it might be something we can help with, we're always happy to do that as well. Yeah, go ahead.
If a professor knows that he or she is going to be out for a class or two throughout the semester sometime, could they reach out to you to have you perhaps speak with them about topic in the class that might be relevant, or come in and take a class with a professor, talk about a history class, talk about maybe the Indiana history a little bit about something like that?
Absolutely. We're actually always looking for a way in order to partner with university classes. Sometimes we'll, like I said, do the full-on class where my students are just, you know, other students that are in that class. We partnered with Tina Kruger several times in her classes because she has a gerontology class. And what we've had them do is actually the students have research papers, and we meet with them at the beginning of the semester and say, okay, these are topics that we're really interested in. Now go do your research paper, and then we'll meet again with them like the next month and check in and say, okay, well, I still have these questions. So we kind of help them along with their research paper, and then at the end of that semester they actually present their research papers back to us, which is kind of great on both ends. We get that information that we're kind of interested in. We get that connection with the university students. In addition, those students kind of have to learn how to deal with having someone else kind of help guide them through their research project, and then having to actually present, because that's something that is a lost art a lot of times, is being able to present in front of a fairly good crowd who is going to ask questions. So it works out really well that way. So we're always looking for university partners as far as something along those lines as well. Any other questions? All right. I do have program guides back on the back table if you're interested in picking one of those up on your way out. And again, if you have any questions, please don't hesitate to call me or email me, and I'm always happy to try and answer them for you. And we're always looking for additional partners. So if you know of an organization that might be interested in partnering with us, please let me know. And we always do trips to local areas, to Rockville or to Clinton or somewhere like that. So if you know of a local area that has like a hidden treasure, I'm always looking for those. We're always looking to go and see something new. And so if you've got any ideas as far as those go, please let me know about that as well. Thank you.
For employees, staff, employees who are also university students who join the Facebook page and exchange textbooks back and forth with each other, there's no charge, and we're hoping that this is an opportunity to help keep some of your college expenses down. The only thing we ask really is that you, when you make arrangements to meet with someone to exchange your textbooks, that you do that in a public place, someplace that's going to be safe for everyone involved. But it's really a neat program, and there are some programs, some flyers about the program on the back table, so please stop by on the way out and pick one up, and join up on Facebook to take advantage of Sarge. We had a conflict in scheduling here with Mr. Klinkscales. He is not able to be here at the moment, so we'll be talking with him in another rep session. But I wanted to let you know that we are working on our spring rep session. Now we're looking at a health, wellness, and life balance slant into the spring program. So more information will be coming with that soon. I see Lauren smiling back there. We'll be talking with her quite a bit, I'm sure, and getting this set up. So if you'd like, we have here, I see Mr. Will Downs with Human Resources is going to be speaking with us about the Department of Labor changes for salaried employees. Mr. Downs is the Associate Vice President for Human Resources, And he's going to let us know a little bit about how these changes may affect or have already affected some employees at ISU. So we'll go ahead and move on a little early if you're all right with that. Thank you very much. We appreciate you coming to speak with us.
Thank you.
Mr. Downs, thank you.
This is one of those topics that I don't know how many of the employees are tired of hearing about it, but I'm kind of, yeah, me too. The Fair Labor Standards Act is something that's under the jurisdiction of the Department of Labor. And what they do is they determine how employees should be paid as far as establishing a minimum wage. They also determine what is considered a reasonable work week and when people should be receiving overtime, and creating those type of guidelines, as well as who should be exempt from overtime and who shouldn't be exempt from overtime. Now, do any of you realize what the minimum wage is currently? That's not fair. Go ahead. And it is what, Pam? It's $7.25 an hour. The reason I'm saying that is I wanted to also let you know how we are approaching some of these things here at ISU. Does someone know what the minimum wage is that we pay here currently at ISU? Yes, Pam?
$11.
$11 an hour. And effective November 1, it will be $11.16 an hour. It will be the minimum salary that we pay for entry-level employees coming to work at ISU. Under the FLSA, the guidelines provide us with minimum requirements of what we need to do for employees. Wage, you know, minimum wage is one of those examples. The other is when to pay overtime and how to pay overtime. The guidelines under the Fair Labor Standards Act dictate that we pay overtime for any hours that are worked in excess of 40 within a work week. Now, we're not talking pay periods here, we're talking within a work week. At ISU, we pay overtime for any hours in excess of 37 and a half within the work week. And that's been done here at ISU probably for 15 plus years now. Also, we don't pay just for overtime on hours worked, we pay overtime on any hours paid. So an example of that is if somebody took vacation on Monday and then Tuesday through Friday, they worked beyond what would normally be their normal work week of 7.5 hours per day. Whatever was excess of 37 and a half, they would still be paid overtime for those hours. And that's something we're not required to do, but it's something that ISU has chosen to do. Now, the last time that anything significantly happened as far as the Fair Labor Standards Act was back in 2004 during the Bush administration. And at that time, they established some guidelines as far as what needed to be considered as far as being able to be eligible for exempt status. And they also established a salary threshold. The salary threshold they established in 2004 was $23,660 annually. Now, I don't think any of us in this day and age thinks that $23,660 is someone being considered exempt from overtime. However, the changes that we've had that have come forward are tremendously greater than that amount. But there's no argument that $23,660 was really too low. And so it's welcome that there is going to be a change in that regard. What also was established at that time, and these guidelines are still in effect till December 1 of this year, by the way, was that, first of all, employees had to be paid on a salary basis, meaning regardless of the quantity or quality of the work they were doing, that they would be paid this annual salary. The minimum salary test then would be the fact that they have to at least be paid the $23,660. Then there's also what is referred to as a duties test, and there's several different categories that they have under the duties test. There's the executive group, administrative, professional, outside sales employees, computer professionals as specifically defined within the Fair Labor Standards Act, and then also the highly compensated. Now, the highly compensated really doesn't have a whole lot of impact because of the fact that most people, if they're highly compensated, are probably going to also be meeting the criteria to be considered an executive employee. And so for the purpose of that, it's really not that significant as far as anything that we would look at. Now, they do have some things that are kind of specific to higher ed or education in general that they've identified. For instance, faculty members or just teachers in general do not fall underneath the guidelines of the Fair Labor Standards Act. So there are no restrictions as far as how much they are paid or any of those requirements. They are considered to be exempt just due because of the profession they are. When it comes to positions such as coaches, as long as 50% of their time is being spent actually instructing the athletes they're working with, giving them direction and guidance as to how they're doing in their sport and those type things, then they're able to be exempt from these criteria as well. Also, there is a category that is referred to as academic administrative position. The academic administrative position was established back in 2004, but I don't think very many people actually looked at it as a criteria or have much interest in it because of the fact that the 23660 was a pretty low threshold at that point in time, and so they really didn't need to give it that much consideration. However, with the recent changes that have come out, most universities have looked at that again and are applying that standard when they look at who can or cannot be considered exempt. The academic administrative people are those who are involved with assisting students with academic problems, advising students concerning their degree requirements, and those who are academic counselors or intervention specialists within the universities. So, that being said, what has changed? Well, President Obama sent a memo to the Secretary of Labor back in March of 2014, and I'm just taking a little excerpt from that. In that memo, he said, "Therefore, I hereby direct you to propose revisions to modernize and streamline the existing overtime regulations to make them easier for both workers and businesses to understand and apply." So that happened back in March of 2014. So ever since then, employers have been trying to guess what kind of guidelines were going to be changed, what kind of thresholds were going to change. And so we've been spending a couple of years just trying to guess and project and anticipate what might be happening. So the fact that this happened in 2016 isn't a big surprise to us. It's kind of a relief in a way because now we finally know what the expectations are. So those final regulations then were published on March of 2016. So it took them 2 years to come up with something to share with us. The biggest change that occurred, other than some tweaking that they did on some of the language, etc., was to raise the salary threshold. And they more than doubled the salary threshold by making it $47,476. They've also stated that they're going to increase that threshold every 3 years. So we have this to look forward to, that they're going to start not only establishing this threshold, but increasing it over a period of time. And then we'll have to try to be guessing each time what that new threshold's going to be. So there'll be a lot of anticipation. They're already trying to anticipate what the next one will be. Now, there's a lot of regulations also as far as Congress is trying to do some things to block it. There's court cases where they're trying to state that it was illegal for them to make these changes. But I don't think any employer is sitting back and thinking anything's going to really change. So we're all moving forward accordingly. the intent behind doing this by the Obama administration was to make it so that more employees were eligible to receive overtime, thereby receiving a better living wage for the work that they did. And in doing this, they also anticipated and made an estimate that 4.2 million workers across the nation would go from being non-exempt, would go from being exempt to being non-exempt and therefore eligible for overtime. That's a lot of people. So when these regulations came out and the new salary threshold, what we did initially here at ISU is say, okay, let's look at everybody we have that's exempt, and let's just do a projection. If we just raised everybody up to the new salary threshold, what would that cost be for the university? So we did that. And just doing that, it was an estimate of about $2.6 million would be the cost to the university if we made that change. Well, obviously, that didn't seem to be the best option for us to pursue at that time. And as a result of that, we had to make some decisions to do some different things in regard to that. One of the things we did was we went back and looked at all of our exempt positions and went through a total analysis of those positions to determine where they would fall into these guidelines. And we did a very conservative approach in doing that because, frankly, I anticipate as a result of these changes that there's probably going to be more monitoring as far as what organizations are doing, as far as how they pay people. And so we took a pretty conservative approach. As a result of this, we had around 120 employees who are moving to a non-exempt status within the university. And we had about 80 employees who were classified as being academic administrative. So those who are made academic administrative, as I said, they have a little bit different criteria, their job responsibilities I mentioned earlier. But the salary threshold for them is whatever the entry level salary is for someone who is a faculty member here at ISU. So the threshold is $36,000 for the academic administrative positions. Now, that's fine for now to use that as a threshold. The reality is that if what we pay that entry-level position changes over the years, then that's going to impact that group and how they're paid as well. So we'll see how that works as we move forward. So with these 120 employees that we were moving to non-exempt status, we had to think through that and think, just how are we going to do that and what do we want to do in regard to doing that? And so what we ended up doing is establishing a brand new classification called a non-exempt professional employee. And there's going to be changes coming out in the handbook, et cetera, to reflect this classification for the university. As a non-exempt professional, what we're doing is realizing that these are still what we consider professional level positions within the university, because the only thing is that we cannot meet the guidelines that have been established by the Department of Labor. But we do not want to take anything away from this group of employees. So what we've done is the same benefits that they've received in the past as far as their vacation accrual, the pension plan that they have contributions to, the target salary program that they participate in, all those things will remain the same. The one thing that is changing is that they are going from being exempt from overtime to being eligible from overtime, and they will start being paid on a biweekly basis rather than on a monthly basis. So we did all this to try to keep them as whole as possible. The negative part of this for this group is that they're going to have to start using Kronos to record their time. They're also going to be paid biweekly, which if you've been paid biweekly all your career is not a big deal. But I can tell you it is a big deal for a number of these employees because even though on an annual basis they're receiving the same pay, when you spread it out over 26 pay periods, it ends up that on a monthly basis, it's going to be a little less, and then there's going to be a couple of months where it will be more than the norm. And so it's going to create a challenge for a number of these employees as far as how they budget what they do with their paychecks. And we've been trying to stress this in the meetings that we've had, that that's something that they really need to take into consideration and work to see what their budget's going to look like and see if they need to modify some of the things as far as how they pay bills. Because, for instance, in my case, since I'm paid monthly, I like to have all those bills at the first part of the month, and that way I know what change I have left for the rest of the month. People have done that. The other thing that's going to be a little different is that as exempt staff, when they travel to conferences and things of that nature, it was a little different in how they were. They didn't have to worry about keeping track of the time that they were spending doing various activities and things. But as non-exempt employees, it will be different, and they get paid according to their travel time and things of that nature based on different criteria and when they leave for these conferences. So it's going to be different in regard to that as well. We've tried to provide some questions and answers that are out on our website for employees. We've got information out there for their supervisors as well to give them some guidance. And we've got some examples of travel, or if they happen to be in positions that actually travel as a result of what the requirements is of their jobs. So this isn't going to be an easy process, but we're in the midst of it now. This last Friday was the last day that they were considered as exempt staff. And so starting this week, they have started recording their time into Kronos. So on November 1, they'll be receiving an adjusted check for the days through the 21st of November, through the 21st of October on that November check. And then they'll be receiving the biweekly checks that will come out in November. So there'll be two biweekly checks in November as well. We made the change when we did because of the fact, as you were, most of us, it's been about 6 years now anyway, I think we've started doing pay increases on November 1. And so for a biweekly person, that first biweekly check in November is when their increases would be reflected. And so that's why we picked the cutoff date that we did for implementation. Even though we're not required to do it until December 1, we've implemented it early. So that's pretty much what's happened and where we've gone in that. Any questions about that? Yes, ma'am.
Was it ever entertained that maybe, and I know we put somewhat of a burden on the university, that for those individuals that the biweekly pay would be like twice a month, so it wouldn't impact their, like what they're receiving monthly, as opposed to like now, it is impacting what they are receiving monthly? I mean, I understand that that would be an extra burden on the university. However, one of the university's goals is to attract and retain all the employees. But by doing this, and I understand it was the federal guidelines, it's really hurting the 120 because, I mean, that is a whole quality of life thing attached to it, like your income to debt ratio, the whole nine yards.
There was some discussion on the best way to move forward on it. And the decision was made not to establish another payroll process, at least at this time anyway. And but I do understand what you're saying. And There's been some discussion about the fact that that is a hardship on a lot of employees as far as adjusting to that, but I don't think there's been any decision as to establishing another payroll classification as far as that's concerned at this point. Any other questions? Yes.
Okay, so as far as the benefits go, so are these going to get the same amount of retirement input that they're getting, that they were getting? The same amount of money going into the retirement that was going in previously?
They'll still have the same 10% of their paycheck would be, or their gross pay would be going into the TI graph, yes.
So it is going off of the gross.
Yes. Other questions? Yes.
Were there any positions that were considered to be merged or eliminated or moved to another area or anything like that?
I'm trying to think if that occurred or not. I'm not aware of that. Now, it's coincidental that Foundation is being moved back into the university at the same time that we're doing this. So it has nothing to do with the Fair Labor Standards Act. But no, we did not eliminate any positions as a result of this. Any other questions? Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Will. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. If you have any recommendations for future rep sessions, we'd like to hear those too. Feel free to call or email me or another member of the staff council with your recommendations. All right, well, thank you all for coming. We appreciate your time, and we'll see you in the spring. Thank you.